I come from a working class background on both sides. My mother was a single mother. She went straight from school to working in factories. She had multiple jobs at any one given time. A result of my mum working multiple jobs was that I would be brought up by other members of my family at time too. So I wasn't always living at home with my family from early childhood. As a result of me moving from place to place, I went to multiple schools. I left home at a very young age, so I left home in my teens, and then I became a ward of social services. And I left school with no GCSEs. I didn't get a single qualification until I was 24 years old.
I'm son of immigrant parents, so my mum and dad came into the country, worked very hard to provide a wonderful life for myself and my siblings. Two amazing parents, but I'm also number five out of six kids. So very loud household, a lot always going on.
I have imposter syndrome, a grand case of imposter syndrome. I will never overcome it. I deal with it. I think it's just something that you manage, you know, be it whether you're a black person, whether you're someone from a lower class area. You constantly feel like you have some form of imposter syndrome because you're in a place where you don't naturally feel like you belong.
You have to learn something that's called code switching. So when I'm with my friends, the guys that I grew up with, my black friends that I grew up with, the way I speak around them is vastly different to how I would speak in a professional setting. Simply for the fact I've learned to code switch. So I've learned how to be one person on one side of things and one person on another side of things. The problem with that is it's actually quite tiring because you're constantly having to be different people in different spaces.
It's interesting that socioeconomic background and class is not a protected characteristic, because I think that growing up in poverty creates a huge amount of disadvantage that is actually not talked about and is not often kind of catered for.
So I think one of the main barriers and challenges for young people to kind of getting on with life is often an absence of positive role models around them, whether that's in the family or the wider environment, the community. So at the Youth Association, we actively expose young people to as many positive role models as possible.
In their home environment, they've got a lot of things that they have to deal with, be it financial problems, you know, emotional problems, mental health problems, things like that. And then when they go to school, school's almost seen to put these additional pressures onto them. So there's additional expectations. You look at families now where they might work two or three jobs and they are still in poverty. People will turn to crime because that's how they manage to pay the bills or how they put food on the table. But the outcome of that is it sets the tone for the working career for the rest of the life.
I think that there's a lot of effects of poverty. There's a lot of opportunities that are not available. So things like where maybe people have had to work from a very young age because they've been supporting the family income.
There's a lot of challenges for young people coming from lower income families to get into the workplace or just to get on with life, really. And the first real one is the fact that there's so much instability. So they're not really sure, should I go for a degree? Should I go for an apprenticeship? If I go for a degree, does that guarantee a job?
I think there just needs to be more of an understanding that social mobility doesn't just stop at giving the funding. I think employability skills should be done across the board, not just in education, but also in work roles. It's a missed opportunity. It should be introduced into schools. It should be introduced into prisons. You know, across the board, individuals need to know how to do things like, how do you do an interview? How do you write your CV? How do you do team working skills to help them build the confidence and see that there's more things out on the horizon?
What we've got in this country at the moment isn't a great education system, but it's scalable. And that's why it works. It's very industrialized. So it's from the Industrial Revolution. So the way it's designed is to create people that learn to be employees so that we can then churn them out and we can just repeat the process.
One of the biggest things that I find with schools in these types of areas is that there's less emphasis around things like entrepreneurship. There's less emphasis about going out there and getting yourself in well-paid jobs or going to university. And there's more emphasis around keeping that working class mentality. So it's almost like, let's keep them working in the factories.
And I think it probably sounds like a cliche, but for a long, long time, the education system has kind of favoured and focused on qualifications, tangible things like that, grades, how well can you do academically, and probably not enough historically on the wider aspects of what bringing up a well-rounded individual means.
I had a business studies teacher when I was in secondary school called Mr. Wright, Mr. Wright with a W, lovely gentleman. And he noticed my ability for getting people to follow me to do bad things, because I was very good at being bad at school. And he noticed that and saw, actually, you know what, maybe there's some entrepreneurial tendencies here that we can actually hone. So he helped me to start my first business along with my parents, which was just selling t-shirts. I print designs on t-shirts, and I managed to convince my friends to take a half day on a Friday, go and sell my t-shirts across the city. So because of that, I kind of knew the path I wanted to go onto. I wanted to perfect my craft in sales.
You've got to really address the difference, I think, between employment and employability skills. How well can you sit in an interview? Okay. You know, how well can you read and write? Okay. But actually, there's a whole load of other stuff here going on in a person's life that needs supporting. If we put a lot, much more emphasis, for example, on giving young people the skills to cope with their own mental well-being, giving young people more confidence in themselves and their own abilities, you're hitting on some really, really crucial wider employability skills that aren't necessarily about interviews, CVs, and qualifications.
The narrative of apprenticeships for businesses changed when the apprenticeship levy came into play. The understanding of the capacity and the potential that apprenticeships can bring into a business, I still feel that it's not necessarily been pushed home as yet. A lot of businesses are underspending on the levy. They don't understand there's over 500 apprenticeships out there now that you can do in a variety of sectors, and you can get that workplace experience, and you can also get paid whilst you're doing it. You've got apprenticeships now for up to level 7 in management. You've got apprenticeships in HR. These are places that individuals from lower class areas or working class areas wouldn't necessarily be able to get through the door with. But with apprenticeships, there's those opportunities there.
It's really pleasing to see, actually, apprenticeships that have been coming out recently having more of a focus now on things like leadership and management, higher level apprenticeships as well. So apprenticeships for young people, but also adults at levels, not just 2 and 3, but also 6 and 7. Because actually, experiences you glean in a workplace, you know, working week in, week out, the experiences you gain in that workplace are really, really important. They're invaluable, and you can't always replicate that in an educational setting.
I think some of the organisations that are very active, I know of, let's say, Cummins in Huddersfield, they're very, very active. They'll go out there, they'll take on young people that are from certain types of backgrounds. They take into consideration that they may not have the GCSEs, they may not have the maths, they may not have their English, they may only have one of them. I feel like if the organisations were to utilise their apprenticeship levies, the larger organisations, and do their strategic people management and people planning a little bit better, and go out into those grassroots communities and see what skills there are out there, there'd be a great opportunity to be able to bring in people from those local communities, put more money into those areas, and to be able to upskill them.
I really encourage employers as well, when looking at things like internships and apprenticeships, to combine that with a real living wage, particularly with traditional internships, where there is an unpaid element of it or a very low paid element of it, that really does discount people who actually need that money to be able to live. They might be supporting themselves, they might be supporting family members.
We pay our community for every insight they provide. The better you get at providing insights, the more you get paid. So from the first point, they're actually earning really, really well with us. The second thing is actually, once they complete a brief for us with one of our clients, whether it's Gymshark or eBay or Amazon Prime Video, they actually get a short paragraph that they're then able to put on their CV, on their resume. So for a young person that's trying to get into the world of work, they're getting paid, they're getting great experience. So then when they walk into an interview with somebody, they can have Amazon Prime Video, PepsiCo and Gymshark on their CV already. So that instantly changes the dynamic of that interview.
We've recognised that equality and diversity is not about treating everybody the same. I know that that's been a question in recruitment for probably the last decade that can kind of catch people out, where people say, oh, well, I just treat everybody the same. I think that there is an enhanced understanding now that it's about creating equality of opportunity, and that sometimes that means that something has to be different for one person or for one group.
When you look at some individuals that are involved in criminal activities, the entrepreneurial skills and the management skills and the, you know, the organization skills that they have, if you take that and you deviate that into legal activities, there's like masses of potential there. Understanding that there's going to be a lot of problems that individuals from working class areas come across. It could be things like childcare. It could be simple things like their own confidence, lacking in their own confidence. It could be things like they may be neurodivergent. You may have to explain things a little bit more and change the way that you do things to accommodate for their needs.
We believe that workplaces can be different. And we've really tried to model that ourselves. So as an organisation, we use a values-based approach to recruitment, which means that we don't put unnecessary barriers in place when we're recruiting for jobs. We believe that the thing that's the most important is that people are coming with a good fit with the values of our organisation. There's a lot of other things that employers can do to try and level that playing field. We have a staff member who joined several years ago who hadn't had a career history of management, but they'd been a coach, they'd run a junior cricket club, they'd done a lot of things that actually demonstrated management skills, even though their previous employment hadn't shown that. And I think being able to look a little bit outside of the box, being able to look more broadly at what skills do you need for that role, and what are the range of ways that people might have been able to demonstrate those skills. It's important, I think, not to discount the way that people have learned their skills.
So the problem with traditional recruitment practices is it focuses too heavily on things like qualifications and relies too much on a 30-minute interview. And that disadvantages people from lower socioeconomic backgrounds. It means they can't compete on a level playing field because they haven't necessarily had that level of cultural capital to be able to handle that 30-minute interview appropriately. For me, what motivates me to employ somebody is the way they walk into the room, the eye contact they're giving me, the smile on the face, the shake of the hand, the amount of interest they take in me and my organisation, the amount of questions they ask, much more than whether they got an A or a B in maths at GCSE.
Everybody loves to talk about something they're excited about. So during the session, we want you to pitch to us what your last favourite holiday was, or what your favourite pair of trainers are, or whatever it may be. And at the end of that, we need to fall in love with whatever it is that you're telling us about. And that's actually what we do during our interview process.
There can be a lot of anxiety coming into a workplace and going, how should I behave? What should I do? Am I allowed to do this? Am I not allowed to do that? Where people might lack the confidence or not know who to ask about it, that can be a real barrier. So we include in our induction, here are the unwritten rules of our workplace as well, just to try and make that process as smooth as possible. So I think another example of where organisations might be inadvertently building in disadvantage is things like how the expenses work. So if you're expecting people to buy their own train tickets, buy their own accommodation and say, oh, you can claim it back at the end of the month, you're making an assumption that somebody's got the cash flow and the money available to be able to make those kind of payments without getting it back straight away. So one of the things that we've done is we have a company debit card now where if it's trains, if it's accommodation, if it's anything that might be a little bit more expensive, that's charged straight to the company.
How you are as an individual is kind of molded to how that organisation wants you to be. Sometimes that can be eased upon a little bit. You know, if we're talking people that are coming from working class areas or they're coming from working class backgrounds, they are down to earth people. You know, they do speak a certain type of way, they may dress a certain type of way. It's almost like that human element of individuals allowing to be themselves is kind of taken away when you go into an organization.
For us, really, the key thing is just to continue to engage them month in, month out, and just say, hey, how are you feeling right now? How is this going? And enabling them to feel like they can come in a free space and say, actually, this is truly how I'm feeling. I'm not engaging with this in a certain way because it just doesn't fit my learning style or whatever it may be. It's those constant check-ins. And I think sometimes in organizations, I've worked in massive insurance companies, you come in, you become a cog of the machine, and then they kind of forget about you.
Having a good line manager is really, really important to that. It's certainly something that we've had feedback on, that it really makes a big difference, that people often, if they feel that they're seen, that they're heard, that they're understood by their manager, are much happier in their work and as a result, often much more productive.
People aren't always ready for work. So young people we work with, perhaps from a deprived background, there's other issues they might have. There might be mental health challenges there. There might be other social behavioral challenges. They might not have much confidence. They might not be self-aware enough. There's a lot of barriers there that means that right now, for that young person, a job isn't necessarily the best thing for them. So a lot of the work we do looks to sort of equalize that a little bit. We don't necessarily approach it from a perspective of let's look at employment and let's look at getting somebody a job. We approach it from a perspective of actually let's support that young person to build themselves more holistically and to gain enough experiences and exposure to different things in life to make them more rounded kind of citizens who'll find their own path.
Historically, we've always supported people towards the labour market and seen work as almost like a panacea of once you get into work, that's it. Our most recent project is called Thriving at Work, and it supports individuals to transition from unemployment. At the point that they become employed, the support can continue with their key worker. It also provides training for people in the workplace and also for employers to support them to look at policies and procedures and things that they can put in place so that work can be that positive step for people.
So if I was in the government and I was going to be trying to design a way that it would be better to engage with people from underestimated backgrounds and get them into work, and I think the key thing for the government to realize is there needs to be different avenues for different people. Imagine we actually asked the people that are going to be engaging with the systems that the government is providing and ask them actually what they want to have. What do they want to receive from the government? As you can imagine, research is a big, big thing for me because it's what I do for my bread and butter. But I think the common thing I see across brands, across governments, across organizations of all sizes is people for some reason don't want to start with the research. If you start with research, you just mitigate so much risk.
Collecting data is one thing, but what good is that data if it's not actioned upon? You know, there needs to be more qualitative data that's brought in from these organisations for their employees. You need to find out what are the issues that are occurring, how do they feel that they're at a disadvantage, how can they be supported? If you're an organisation that looks like you really listen to your employees, then you're going to get more people through the door and you're going to get loyal people.
Collecting data is only important if you use it. So I think that you can get into a position of thinking, oh, it's really important that we collect this, but where it becomes useful is where you use it to inform change. A really good example is in recruitment. So where it's about who is applying for this job, and you see that there's a very specific demographic of people that are applying for the job, and there's actually big groups of people that are not applying. It makes you ask those questions to say, well, is it because we've not advertised in the right places? Is it because we've not liaised with the right people? Is it because there's something about the language that we've used that has made it appealing to some groups and not appealing to other groups?
I think I put much more funds into the wider journey of a young person growing up. I would be looking much more sharply at what can services and professions do to support young people more holistically. So what can we do to improve young people's confidence? What can we do to improve their access to work placements? What can we do to improve young people's access to mental health services? Because once you break down some of those barriers, that's when you're more likely to have young people more empowered generally in life, more in touch with themselves and self-aware, to hold down jobs.
So it's a really interesting one about cost, because I think that often programs are designed to be as cheap as they can. And I think there's a huge false economy in it. We've worked with people on our programs who have already been through 5, 6, 7 employability programs that haven't worked because it's been maybe much more short term. There's been a need to try and move forward and not look at what people's barriers are. And I think for people where their barriers are more complex, where there might be multifaceted things going on in their lives, I don't think there's anything that works as well as that one-to-one support.
So if there's one piece of advice I'd put out there for young people, particularly young people from lower socioeconomic backgrounds, always present the best image of yourself because that's going to be the motivating factor for an employer and be ready to sell yourself. Almost have your own little elevator pitch that pictures you as a person to those around you, because you never know when the next opportunity is about to hit you.